she asked me what, well, you asked me my, where I'm coming from on the Proposition 64, the legalization of marijuana.
Yeah.
When it comes to youth, and I think marijuana, like alcohol, should only be for adults. I think part of the money that you make from marijuana should be used as an education, should put an education program together in our schools to warn kids of the danger of using drugs. And we're going to have to struggle with legalization here and how to codify, you know, where a cannabis club can be, if that's what they're going to be called, and, you know, keep them away from schools, keep them away from churches.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, I don't think the city should glorify them. I mean, if we have a pot festival, that's fine. They can come and get a grocery permit or get whatever, but I don't think the city should sponsor them.
What about wine
festival
and beer and all the drugs?
Right. Oh, I agree.
They have a wine festival, a beer festival.
But the city doesn't sponsor that.
We don't sponsor that.
Well, you endorse it. You it's legitimate.
Well, I mean,
you don't have to sponsor the pot thing either. Just
they can come to the city and
crazy.
You know, we can give them encroachment permits, and we can give them, you know, you're to do this, you're going to have to get the insurance policy. You know,
fine, whatever,
blah, blah, blah.
Whatever is required.
If it's a private
bars.
Property, that's fine.
Yep.
I don't know that we would want to use city property for something like that. You know, you still, we're going to have to change our, we're talking about alcohol now, we are going to have to change our code because we don't allow alcohol in city parks, and yet we are going to perhaps allow weddings and things like that out on the, you know, bluffs. If people come and they event, there's it could be a cost involved, so we'd have to change it to allow alcohol.
Well, that could perform the ceremony. They don't have to have alcohol.
No.
So that wouldn't change necessarily. You have the ceremonies there and you have the festivities someplace else.
Well,
you don't want to drink it on the headless.
No. But the noise, for instance, we had a League of California Cities came here for a, the Revenue Empire Division had their meeting here.
Okay.
And so we showed them around, we took them out to the Noyo Center, and no one was getting drunk, but North Coast Brewery was there because they were part of the city and they were letting them taste their beers, and so alcohol was being served. It wasn't a party situation, it was a quick social situation, and so, you know, we have to be able to address certain exceptions.
Well, permits. With permits.
Yeah, right.
You
exactly. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's the answer.
But my personal opinion is we need to educate our youth as part of this whole legalization process that it's going to be just like alcohol.
It's very simple.
And I know when I was a kid, I took drivers. You had to have driver's education and driver training in high school.
Yep, we did.
Driver's education, of course, it's not like today with YouTube and everything. They had films of these horrific car wrecks, absolutely horrific car wrecks, and they didn't censor them one bit. And we just sat there, I remember, as a teenager, you know, just turning 16, looking at this and almost throwing up.
Yeah,
it was so horrible. And yeah, you know, you still made mistakes and had a few beers and drove at times, but it sure drove home the point. And, you know, I don't know, you know, then we had the driver's training and they tell you how to drive and everything, but the point is, there was a component of when you're going to drive and drink at the same time, you know, this is the danger.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want to exaggerate like,
Reefer Madness.
Reefer Madness. But I mean, there should be some sort of educational component, like when you learn to drive.
First 100 hours
you
a kid drives, is a huge percentage chance they're going to have an accident.
Right. And so, you know, there's one part of the educational program, the driving training part, that I think it would be helpful. And I think in schools, you know, it's very helpful to have like an ex-gang member or somebody that's been through the drug problem.
Very
simple. Talk to them, very motivational speakers, you know.
That doesn't work. It's not going to happen to them. That accident isn't going to happen to them. It has no effect.
Well, no,
very
I'm talking about marijuana. I'm talking about just the dangers of drug use in general.
It's very simple.
But I'm going to be very frank here. I favor medicinal marijuana. cancer. There's been some very solid evidence mm-hmm. that marijuana is definitely a very effective medicine in treating certain things.
You've met Jude Filman, I think. She
yes.
loves Dragonfly.
Dragonfly, yes.
She's a very eloquent speaker about the beneficial
right.
effects of medicinal cannabis.
Right.
She said most of her customers out there are seniors.
Right.
They are tired of being in pain and
right.
of being on opioids that
exactly.
make
and
them feel like crap.
And see, that's the
and
other thing. The opioid epidemic is terrible in our community and everywhere else.
Right.
And
apparently it's been much improved in Colorado,
right.
which is interesting that people are now choosing
right.
safer pain relief.
Right, exactly.
Opioids are not...
And I just know from being, you know, growing up when I did, and, you know, at one point in my life using pot and watching other people on opioids and seeing the difference. I mean, it's clear, it's pretty clear to me.
No kidding.
I think the pot
yeah.
problem and the drug problem is easily cured. I don't know what you can do legally to impose this, but you can eliminate all the drug problems if kids, say, when they get their driver's license until they're 21, or if you're in a school and you're getting school funds that are paying for the school, all you have to do is periodically and sporadically drug test them.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't know when that's going to happen. But then they cannot go out and smoke pot. If you're on a sports team, you can't use drugs, and you're going to be tested.
And they don't do so.
You do that to everybody. You cannot drive a car
right.
without taking a urine test sporadically when it's you're requested, and that way they don't want to lose their license. They don't want to stop driving. They will not do drugs till they're 21. At least that covered. You take care of that period. End of story.
Well, it works with athletes. I know that.
Well, it would work. Anyone who wants to drive, everybody would do it.
My son went to San Francisco State to play baseball.
Okay. Had to take the test.
He was the player on the team that
right.
got randomly selected
okay.
one time. He had to go in and beat
really?
It up. And, oh, yeah.
Wow.
And, you know, he passed at that time of life. I mean, he probably wouldn't have
lucky.
Back in high school here because every kid.
No, of course they're doing it. It's
yeah.
the peer pressure. It's the party.
Percent.
But now you say, hey, we can't do that. They're going to test us. We can't do it. So a drug test will solve.
Is that percentage going down? Do you have a year-by-year comparative analysis
well,
on that?
I'll have to find out. There's something called a California Healthy Kids Survey that's given to grades 7, 9, and 11 every other year.
Mm-hmm.
And drug use is one of the things that they self-report on. So I think that the pot use from the most recent survey to the one before that stayed about the same.
Mm-hmm.
And it was about 20% of the high school juniors who used in the last 30 days.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, 80% aren't.
Right.
And, you know, it's all self-reporting.
That's good. I mean, that's today. I'm just wondering how it was like 10 years ago, 20
yeah.
years ago, 15 years ago.
I don't know if we have data that far back.
Okay.
But I'll ask.
It'd just be nice to see what kind of trend is going on.
Yeah.
Because, okay.
Well, Lenny, if you got time, I'm
going to
ask you these. There's only five.
Okay,
and
here we go.
He doesn't want to be interviewed.
No, I don't mind. I just say I don't think I'll have anything particularly insightful over what a younger person.
Thomas always does.
With these interviews, there's really no wrong person interview. Okay, so some of the youth in our community are choosing to use marijuana. Why do you think they're doing that?
Most likely because peer pressure. Also, there are not a lot of opportunities here in our community that cater to that age.
Mm-hmm.
People like to hunt. People like to fish. We have some great mountain bike trails and that
mm-hmm.
sort of thing, but...
Mm-hmm.
Oftentimes, that particular age group, you're looking for excitement, you're looking
mm-hmm.
for fun. But I'd say peer pressure is the greatest reason why.
Okay. The next question is, how do you think the youth in our community are obtaining the marijuana they use?
There are certain kids that maybe even with their parents' blessing, I don't know, because you can make a lot of money. But there's a lot of growers, and growers have kids just like everybody else,
mm-hmm.
and they can't hide, I don't think, making income off their own property growing, especially indoor from a kid.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I think they're probably getting it locally might be stealing it from their parents' top drawer too, who knows, you know, mm-hmm. I mean, there's high usage in this community and everywhere else, really.
Right, good boy.
But more so here, only because the growing opportunities are a lot better here.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So the third one is, do you think it's acceptable for our youth to use marijuana? If yes, why? If no, why not? You were saying medicinal.
Yes, for medicinal reasons. Mm-hmm.
You were saying epilepsy and
epilepsy, autism. Certain forms of cancer. I know the cannabinoid oil is also effective in treating certain injuries. I'm not sure if it's ligaments or, you know, sprains, but I'm told that it's also helpful in relieving pain in certain areas of your body that are, you know, that have ligaments and muscles and
mm-hmm.
things like that. And again, this isn't the THC-based oil, this is the cannabinoid-based oil.
Mm-hmm.
But in terms of smoking pot, kids are going to be kids. And I'll be honest here, but, you know, my son, he's now 30, graduated from law school, he's doing great, everything's in a locus. And, but when he was in high school, I caught him, discussion with him, and kids are going to be kids. They were, you know, he was continuing to smoke pot with his friends. And I know this is on Facebook, but I mean, eventually I said, you know what? If you're going to do it, go in the garage. I don't want to know. I put a TV out there, I put video games out there, you just stay here. Don't go anywhere else. If they want to stay overnight, they can stay overnight.
We did something similar in our backyard. We called it the Jack Shack.
So, you know, sometimes if you come down too hard and try and fight something that seems to be inevitable, that's even going to make the attraction greater.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't favor kids using pot. There are some venues. I think musicians oftentimes get more creative. Artists get more creative.
Mm-hmm.
For whatever reason, there are some qualities to marijuana that bring out certain traits in creativity,
mm-hmm.
more so than not. But overall, I mean, as a general rule, I would dissuade you from using marijuana, and definitely dissuade you from any other drug, LSD,
mm-hmm.
cocaine, any of that. Absolutely
mm-hmm.
not. But if you had to say, okay, you can choose one drug, I would, you know, go ahead.
Yeah.
Smoke pot.
The one that has the fewest side effects that
right.
are lasting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That we know of. A lot of testing has been done, and I haven't seen anything yet conclusive that it's, you know, killing brain cells or that it's, you know,
well,
harming you. I know at a certain age there have been some studies done where it seems to affect your
brain development.
Capabilities and your
yeah.
brain development.
Yeah, yeah.
And so, you know, there's, you know, I'm just thinking in the long run when you become an adult. But it's not, you know, it's reality is actually really fun. You know, the real world's fun. And it's great to remember where you left your keys. And, you know, and what you said to somebody the night before, or, you know,
right.
be responsible for your actions.
Yep.
So,
yep.
I would not try and tell someone not to use it, but I would tell them, you know, you're probably going to be a lot happier if you don't.
Yeah, yeah.
In the long run.
Well, I mean, for a long time, I was hearing that studies have shown that it adversely affects brain development if you smoke before the age of 25, because that's kind of when
right.
your brain keeps developing that long.
Mm-hmm.
And now the most recent one I saw was that age is actually 17.
Mm-hmm.
There doesn't seem to be a lot of difference between kids' brain development between the ages of 17 and 25 if they do or don't smoke pot. Before 17,
mm-hmm.
yes.
Right.
So if kids are using a lot of pot before the age of 17, they're definitely altering.
Well, you know, when I grew up, I graduated high school in 1970. Okay, Davis was a college town where I graduated from high school. But in junior high, no one was, you know, I don't know how it was anywhere else, but I mean, kids weren't smoking pot until they got into high school. And if they very careful about their use.
Yes.
It's just so prevalent now, and
right.
People are, you know, going to Harvest Market, you can smell in the parking lot or
yep.
whatever. I mean, people, I didn't mean to say, our, you know, say wherever, you know,
yeah.
a local business in
well,
general.
I was at Safe Passage the other night. I was at a Thursday night meeting, and here somebody was standing outside on the patio smoking pot. And I thought, wow, that's bold.
Yeah.
And, you know, because they're on a school campus land, on school land, they aren't supposed to smoke anything.
Right.
But I thought, it's not illegal anymore.
Yeah.
You know, he was an adult.
Right. But what's illegal now is you can't smoke in public buildings, you can't smoke within 20 feet of a business downtown, you know, so we're going to enforce the same laws that are on the books for cigarettes.
For cigarettes.
It's going to be on for marijuana.
So that,
I guarantee you that.
That alone is going to restrict it.
It should.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And we need our officers, of course, to enforce the laws.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. And that's, it's tricky with cigarettes. It's a little
right.
more obviously needed with somebody's got rolling a doobie. Okay, so how about this? What do you think, we've got two questions left. What do you think we as a community could do to discourage youth from using marijuana? If that's what, in fact, we want to do. Do we want to discourage them, and if so, what could we do?
Well, again, I think if we're collecting any kind of tax revenue, that some of that revenue should be used to promote some educational programs within our school systems.
Okay.
And in conjunction with the school districts, obviously, the United States is different than a lot of countries. The school district is actually part of City Hall. Japan, for instance, is part of the, you know, whereas we have separate districts, and so there's, but I think we could certainly work with the school districts to use some of the funds that we collect to have an education program in our school, in our schools. That's I would push for that.
Okay, that's a good answer. And the last question is, now that recreational marijuana use is legal for those over 21, what policies should be put into place by our city council to regulate how it is produced and sold and consumed? And I know
that's
this is
what
the
we're
topic.
Doing right now.
Yeah. And so the answer is you're working on it.
We're working on it.
Yeah.
We are, and you know, we have to decide. Obviously, we have dealt with codifying the manufacturing of marijuana products, not actual products, but there's a, you know, the root one, there's a business that came to us and with medicinal marijuana being the primary use before Prop 64 passed, we had to come up with something in the municipal code to address this business because it's a new business and we didn't have a business like this before, so we had to, you know, number one, we want them in industrial, light industrial, and it can't be downtown.
Mm-hmm.
You can't have signage that really, you know, has neon arrows pointing to what it is and what they're doing. They have to work with the police chief to make it secure. They have to control the odor, you know. So we came up with a way to address the manufacturing of oil that will be used in edible products. You know, has to be tested. All these things. And so the same thing is going to have to be done now for cannabis clubs or retail marijuana shops. Should they be in the central business district or not? You know, what hours are, you know, everything, because that business does not exist.
Yeah.
And you know how alcohol is controlled very strictly. The transportation of alcohol is completely different than the transportation of lettuce. The sale of alcohol is completely different. You know, you need a license, and so all that, you need a license, we're going to have to come up with all that. It has to be controlled.
Yeah.
And that's the whole idea, is to make sure you control it. You know, will we limit the amount of businesses that's possible?
Mm-hmm.
Then on the other side, you've got people here who have been doing this for a while, that have opened medicinal marijuana dispensaries.
Mm-hmm.
Notice they're not in central business district, because we made it kind of difficult for that.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, tourists are coming. It's going to be all over California. We're known for growing marijuana here, just as, you know, Anderson Valley is known for wine.
Wine tours.
So, you know, in some ways, I don't know that you want to use the word embrace, but at the same time, you know, we're going to have to accept the fact that it's here, and maybe if there's a way to make it so it's not too difficult to have some sort of club or recreational use area or dispensary or retail outlet or tours. That's okay. I mean, that's what the people of California voted for. That's what they want. It's legal. So obviously you can't be less restrictive than a state regulation. You could be more restrictive. And so there's somewhere in there where we're going to have to land.
Yeah. I went to your public safety committee meeting with the fellow from the League of California Cities to the PowerPoint. I thought he was great.
He was. I thought that was too.
And, you know, really knew about how other cities were handling this and had some good advice. I thought his advice was very interesting about the tax rate Colorado first adopted, and they chose to lower it because the black market was still thriving. Legal pot was too expensive.
And that's what we don't want here.
Yeah.
Because we're in an area where the grow sites are totally ruining the environment.
Yeah.
Making it dangerous to enjoy outdoor activities for people, making it dangerous for the logging companies to do work. So
dangerous for wildlife, dangerous for downstream water. So yeah, it's as long as that continues to be profitable, it will continue to happen, I'm afraid. So yeah, anyway, he was concerned that California's tax rate was just going to be way too high.
Right, well, it's 15%. Excise tax. Then the county's tacked on about another 5 or something.
And just
that's
to go
20.
Just to go into business at all, the fees are really steep. So, you know, I get it that some folks will not join the fold.
Right.
But they're not going to give up their business.
Right.
So
then again, you can also grow your own personal use marijuana.
Right. If you're not
it's
in
not
business.
That difficult. Yeah. I mean, if you
that's
want to
true.
Save money or whatever.
That's true. You can grow your own. So what's the law about that, as far as growing your own? Is it like 6 plants or something?
No, I think it's 9
6
or 9.
9 plants where you don't need anything if you're not intending to sell it.
Right.
Yeah.
For your own personal use.
Yeah, so I'm sure that would become more common too. I think it's supposed to be more or less invisible. I mean, not visible from the street.
Right. Oh, yeah.
But
yeah, there's
backyards.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, outdoor, I guess, from what I've meetings here, one of the not just you, there was another fellow, Simeon, who came up, and he was saying how indoor marijuana now is preferred. Because it's, I guess, not the potency is probably the same either way, but you don't have to worry about
gophers.
Well, yeah, see, you have to treat outdoor pot, I think, and who knows what they do on these illegal grow sites, but I know they use rodenticides, they use all kinds of crazy, horrible stuff just to protect their plants, and some of it obviously is getting into the system. And so, and it's not tested. See, the nice thing about legalization is here, there's just like anything else with the Food and Drug Administration, they're going to require to undergo testing.
Track and trace.
They have to know exactly,
I saw a fellow who owns a track and trace company give a presentation to the Board of Supervisors a couple months back. Thank God, he looked like he ran a Fortune 500 company. I mean, this was a very spiffy looking fella.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, it's complicated. It's basically barcoding the product so that it can be traced and tested.
Right.
And, this has really come a long way when it comes to the technology of growing marijuana for profit.
Right.
It's very well developed.
I think indoor is more secure, too.
Probably.
But people who are really wanting to make a lot of money are going to need large areas to grow, and that's another thing we're going to have to address. I don't know so much in town we have large areas.
Probably not.
But the mill side, I mean, what if you want to build a greenhouse out there?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. I mean, these are things that we're going to have to struggle with.
I don't envy you, Lindy. These are hard decisions.
Yeah.
I don't envy you a bit. I mean, these are the questions that were, when I went to that public safety committee meeting, these were the ones that that were on the document that was handed out, that you had directed city staff to research. So anyway, my question is, if I send this out to, I've got like about 500 people on my e-list that I send out at Safe Passage. Is it okay with you if I say, if you care, if you have an opinion about this stuff, 8:30 Monday morning is the time to show up at that meeting? Are you okay with that?
Yeah, that's the
26th.
Right.
Debbie Desmond attends the CDAP meetings.
just remember that I'm here at 11. So if 11 people show up,
right,
they're not going to be able to comment all. I mean, you know, and the meeting, I think, is on a...
It's
day?
Monday morning.
That's what I thought.
A week
right.
from today.
Right.
8:30.
Exactly. So,
and
right.
it's at Town Hall?
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, I don't... It's hard to imagine that you're going to get a huge response at 8:30 in the morning. So,
right.
you know, I don't think you're going to have all kinds of people.
No, yeah,
but I
yeah.
feel like it's my job as part of this public health grant that Safe Message has, where we're supposed to be working on underage drug and alcohol
right.
use, you know, prevention. That if people care, this is
right.
their chance to tell you.
Right.
And
yeah.
I suspect most people do not care.
Right. Well, if they care, they could, you know, they could show up. They could also email.
Email, right.
Yeah.
Email you and Bernie.
Yeah, we're on the committee.
Yeah. Okay, well,
let us know, and then we can put that on the record, you know, so that'll go into the file.
Okay, as a public comment.
Right.
Okay, well, maybe I'll put that in the email too, but
right.
if you can't attend the meeting, you can email the two members of the committee.
Right.
Okay, well, that'd be great.
Okay.
Then I can at least say that I tried to give people the opportunity
right.
to speak up if they have an opinion.
Right. What do you think is, I mean, that's what this meeting's about too, is to hear back from people in the community. What do you think? Because you're real active, you follow what's going on. I mean, what do you think about marijuana being legalized and how the city should go about trying to grapple with?
Has anyone ever asked the 10th, 11th, and 12th graders, giving them a survey and say, what reward or incentive, or what would you do to give up any aspect of any drugs, alcohol, or marijuana until you were 21, what would you, what would it take to have you sign a pledge that you wouldn't do that?
Yeah, I don't know.
Well, that's what
if
you
that's
would ask
happened.
Them. That's why you would ask them. Because I have a feeling, any one kid in the world, if I said to him, when you graduate, do you want $10,000, or would you like a nice used car that you can pick out if you don't do any drugs or alcohol until you get out of high school and you'll be tested once a month? Would you take that pledge and every single one of them would say yes?
Well, then who's buying the car? I mean,
you don't get in the car and say, I'm sorry, I lied to you, but you got out of high school without doing drugs. Now, I don't know, but I'm saying there is an answer, and if it has a price, then you have to determine, can you afford it? But mm-hmm. I would ask them, what's it going to do? Why would I go to them and say, I'm going to give you a rabbit hat, a pair of slippers if you don't do it? I don't know, what is it? Each one might have a different one. But I would think if the city underwrote that, we'd all save money. That's all. They're going to drive a car and kill someone. They're going to become a drug addict. They're going to murder someone, whatever. If you stop people from doing drugs till they got out of high school, very few would, you know, go on to serious drug problems. So I would ask them what it would take.
Yeah.
Well,
and they
it's a role model, too, you know. It's a.
It's the peer pressure. 100%. You said it's a peer pressure. 100%.
Exactly.
You know, somebody who's more popular, a little bit taller here, try
right.
to. And when you talk about starting drugs, in my day, it was having a beer was a big thing. My kids were smoking marijuana. Now they have drugs made out of chemicals. You have one, and the next day your brain doesn't even know what it did, but it wants more of it. You're hooked within a couple of days.
Right.
I mean, it's the thing is terrifying now.
It's scary.
I would hate to try and grow up.
Yeah.
And
that's the thing about marijuana. That's why I'm, you know, if you're going to tell a kid, I mean, meth, I mean, there's all these other terrible crack, all that stuff. Compared to marijuana, it's almost like, look, just the marijuana.
No, it's
won't
do it. I'll get you a car. I mean, you're going to be drug tested every month.
Right.
You don't do any drinking or smoking if you want that car. If you do, I'm taking the car away. Now, when he is at the party and the kid says, try this, he says, I'd love to, but I don't want to lose my car.
Right.
So he can say no without saying I'm chicken or I'm too.
Well, and then we've got the illegal drugs, we've got the opioids, and we've got parties where kids steal drugs out of their parents' cabinets and mix them all in a hat and
yeah.
go around and they take one out and they don't even know what they're taking. And that's
skills parties.
Yeah. And
yeah.
so I try to follow all this stuff, but it's kind of scary.
It
I'm sure
scary.
Glad that. Son's 30 years old and,
yeah.
and through all that.
I feel glad. I feel like
I got through my
boys.
Youth, you know, and I was lucky because I had sports. You know,
mm-hmm.
I'm not saying I never smoked marijuana, but I mean, when you play high school basketball, football, and I played college basketball and baseball, everything is.
You're too busy.
And
you spend a lot of time
yeah.
getting started.
patterns of drinking, there's liquor stores, there's bars, and all I want to do is smoke. I don't want to get drunk and run it, you know. So it's very hypocritical to permit one and then give a lecture on the other.
Right. Yeah.
So I think a pot festival would be fine because you could have education in it, you could have the benefits of it, and there's no doubt there are a lot of health-related benefits. Remember my idea for the name of the festival? You see, that's why.
What is it?
The second or third annual, we don't remember which.
I forgot.
See, that's it. That's the third. And it could be the other name.
All right. Well, thanks for your time, Lenny. You sure you don't want to be interviewed?
No, he covered every single point that I would have added to it. You know, so he put ditto marks on there. Seriously.
Well,
I commend you for your work.
Thank you. Yeah, it's interesting work.
And I should say, Councilmember Simolino, he reports on CDL.
Yes, he usually
does. On a regular basis.
Yeah,
he keeps us informed of what's going on.
But the gang thing, you have to look at it as a tsunami. And it is a tsunami. And when the tsunami's coming at you, you don't figure out how I'm going to stop it or turn it around. Ride with it. How can I take this gang, organization, energy, ambition, desire, and turn it into a positive?
Well,
and then you'll have the answer.
Believe me, I wish.
That's to work on. Don't fight them. Ask them. Go out and ask them.
Yeah, well, you should talk to Connie Belli, who runs Snowy Hill High School and Lighthouse School, where the gangbangers go to school.
Okay.
I mean, these are complicated situations.
Well, there's a lot of,
if they were easy to solve, she would have already.
And there's a cultural aspect to it as well, and a sociological aspect, and an ethnic aspect to it.
80% of it's economic aspects to it. Those people had the wherewithal to live the way they wanted, and job opportunities, and school,
right,
and all that. And it's not just here, it's where they came from, it's what drove them here.
Right.
It's economics. Economics. We're doing exactly the opposite of what we should be doing economically.
But what surprises me is this. I think the Hispanic culture is fantastic in that family comes first. They go to church. They love their kids. They spend, you know, and yet we've got a real problem with Hispanic gang members. So, you know, how.
So they're treated. They know they're like the black people to many people. You don't always like to be in their skin.
No, I do.
They know people are looking at them differently. They're uncomfortable.
Well,
they don't give them the jobs.
Some people do.
There's a fellow in Ukiah, his name is Carlos Hacienda, who's a great fellow, and I've gotten to know Carlos a bit. And he does a lot of gang resistance stuff. But he has a presentation that he gives to Latino families that's really powerful, and it's about that very thing. It really talks about this, the traditional values in Mexican culture, and how the gangs are completely against those traditional values.
That's
he's saying, you're throwing away your heritage when you join a gang.
Right.
You're spitting on it.
And that was my point exactly.
The Mayans, I bet there aren't as many Mayan Mexicans in these gangs as there are.
I don't know. You
they have
right.
A very strong culture they carry forward with pride.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
yeah, but
that's all it takes. They've been treated too poorly for too long, and now Trump is aggravating it as much as by assaulting people.
Yeah, it's not.
Started.
Yeah.
Yeah. Other thing.
It is economics, but it's also, you know, the broken homes now.
Mm-hmm.
That's economics too.
Oh, well,
they both have to work,
right?
You know, I mean, you have to leave, go to another country to send home. You know how much money we send to Mexico?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
They want their families here. They don't want to send it there. It's all economics.
Yeah.
Well, that's a big part of it. You're right.
Sure.
Absolutely.
Get rid of the war and put that money to use, and we'd be fine. Really.
Yeah.
Pretty.
Yeah.
So sad.
All right,
guys. Well, thanks.
Hey, thank you.
Okay.
I appreciate your time.
Yeah, I'm glad you're
nice
able
to meet you.
My pleasure.
Get my email and get down here.
Yeah.
I just saw that this morning.
Oh, that's perfect.
This is the perfect.
I'm so glad. You and my coworker Ann Harvey's been here to visit you before, and she reminded me that you have this opportunity every Monday,
right,
which is a good idea.
Yeah.
So I'm glad I was available today.
Now, if you have other choices.
Yeah,
you
have Doug, you're on.
What? You were ready for us, you're ranking or something?
Sure.
What is your prediction of the effect on downtown Fort Bragg when the mill site is built? You've approved the hotel and shopping center.
Well, we don't want to turn this into economic life downtown. In other words, we can't put all our energy out there on the mill site and then have sort of a new Fort Bragg and an old Fort Bragg. I mean, it's got to be one community. And so, obviously, whatever happens out there has to be a companion to what's going on in town. We don't want to kill the central business district by creating a different business district.
That's what you're doing. Obviously, the whole design and the whole structure.
Nothing's been designed yet. We've come up with some zoning.
It's going in the direction of the Santa Rosa and everything else. You want a hotel, you want a 40-unit shopping center and all this other stuff. I've seen the preliminary.
What have you seen that I haven't? Where's the hotel?
Well, I thought there was a preliminary plan that included in the mill site would be a hotel and a shopping center.
Well, right now we're updating the general plan with an amendment to the LCP, the Local Coastal Program. We haven't even decided how the zoning is going to be. You know, do you want to zone it 100%? Do you want to zone it 30? Whatever Marie's making charts right now.
Can you zone it non-development?
You could just say, let's leave it to the animals.
Leave it to who?
Leave it to the animals.
Well,
I mean, there are people that are for that.
Well, sure.
I don't want anything out there.
You know, if you...
Then there are those that want, you know, my vision, I guess you could say, would be to, when I use the word companion, I mean them in zoning. So right now, we have housing out on Stewart Street. North end of town, and northwest part of town. So the housing development,
yeah,
West Beach.
Yeah.
So if we're going to have housing on the mill site, it should be on that part of the mill site, rather than put something else there.
That's where all the pollution is that they're going to cement over.
Well, in certain areas, yes. I mean, I'm not talking about the whole mill site. I'm just saying, if you're going to have residential zoning on the mill site, it should be companion to where residential zoning is in town right now. If you're going to have highway visitor commercial, like Safeway, like Taco Bell, like gas stations, then it should be right across the street from where that is. I'm just giving you what I think, you know, makes the most sense. I'm not a planner, but this to me would make the most sense. I would still like to see a park right here in the Central Business District, where the Central Business District hits the mill site, where the old main entrance was, where the parking lot is for the
where Oak Street comes into
for the old company store.
Yeah, okay.
Redwood Avenue, whatever. A park, and that's where I thought the Daylighting the Creeks would work nicely too.
Lovely.
A nice park there in the central, and then there has to be some industrial out there, light industrial.
There has to be.
So, well, I mean, in my opinion, because that's where the jobs are, it'd be nice to have some more jobs. We talked about economics. I mean, you can't have good economics unless you have good paying jobs. And if you don't have good paying jobs, it's going to be one vicious circle back to the gangs and the trouble.
No one's going to manufacture here because of the cost of getting the goods.
Well, the breweries. The breweries, I agree.
Yeah, but now alcohol's a different profit
right.
center. But
no, you're right, because I've looked into it. We don't have a deep water port. We don't have an airport. We don't have a freeway. The scum train is...
Exactly. It's good and bad. It's kept as beautiful as it is. If you walk around this town, I have to tell you, for half dozen blocks on Main Street and Laurel and Franklin, it's as nice as any town in America. I mean, fabulous.
I agree.
And to keep it as is. Also, if you think ahead 30, 50, 75 years, I mean, just envision that, at that space being as it is right now, it would be, it'd be like just building a gold mine you can't dig for 75 years. It's like Central Park in New York. It would be the most amazing thing on the California coast, and to let the people 75 years in the head do what they think can best be done with it, because the building materials and everything else would be a whole different world. Don't do anything. And I've offered to you this before, because I will take the responsibility, because when it comes to doing nothing...
You're good at that.
I got references.
Well,
so think of it. That's all I'm saying is think of the fact in 50 years... What the possibilities would be inch of space into
their mouth.
Oh, you're just that passive.
The last thing I want to see is a series of quick decisions that turn into strict laws and things that.
Well, even if they're pretty, even if it's, this is a lovely shopping center, they're closing it for us America.
No one's
going to come here to go to Target.
That's why I don't think we'd want to put a box store out there.
All right, now a couple other things I've got out of your way here. This could be Fort Bragg, is the, you know, where the artichoke capital is, and you know where the forest capital is.
Right.
This could be the art capital of America.
Mm-hmm.
I suggested this to you before, but we start with one building. I can maybe get Professor Don Snyder, the Wayne Weather building, and we say to artists, come in and paint this building. You can do a door, you can do a window, you can do a roof,
mm-hmm.
but you have to submit the design, and Don, as the owner of the building, has to approve doing it. And then inch by inch, we do the roads. We do the sidewalks. We do everything in this town over a period of years. Artists from around the world who want to leave their signature. It's like my son took a granddaughter.
Yeah, that's a great idea. Other than the fact that the paint doesn't last too long in our climate. But
even better, the fact that paint it over again. It's like a tattoo. You can sell it over again. Also, you would get, I guarantee, a paint company to donate that free. All those paints in that art capital of America are from, we make them. They wouldn't have to pay for it. But some people, I spoke to an artist about this, and I said to him, we were looking at what building was it? One of the buildings on Main Street, it was so nice. And I said, if you were going to paint that building to make it really stand out, what would you do? He said, I would paint a mirror image of the building behind me on that building,
mm-hmm.
which is just, you know, a bit of brilliance. That's one artist. But when you think of all the items, the objects, some would be, you know, like Ibansky or whatever, he's selling his poster, you know, he paints the artwork all around, it's going for millions of dollars now. You heard about him?
No.
Ibansky. Anyway, so I would think there's a lot of artists here to get started,
mm-hmm.
and nothing's going to be done until the owner looks at it and says, okay, you can do this. And believe me, in not too many years, people would be coming here on vacation so that they could have the honor of painting something. It doesn't have to be whatever. There's a lot of buildings. People might even want to start doing their houses if you move out of town.
Right.
But
how would the city be involved in that, other than just
promoting it? Well, one, approving it, promoting it. They have a lot of buildings here. Can you imagine
right.
if you let them? They did a beautiful job painting this thing.
Right, right. Well, we have scenic corridor, and we do have some guidelines that we review in terms of colors. That really came into place with the Northcliff Motel.
Well, again, in this, have you ever been to some of those Caribbean islands or Dutch cities or other places?
Sure. Look at Moscow.
Perfect. Okay.
Yeah.
So, you know, the town doesn't do that. We don't raise the tax and get millions
right.
of dollars. In. Each inch or square foot or whatever we want to do, it's going to be an artist.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to do. It's going to be the art capital of America. Imagine that road out front painted. Each road, each side a different color. The lines down the middle, a different color. The side, everything in town would
right.
be colorful.
Right.
So
I don't know about the roads, but
why not the roads? Look at the yellow brick road to Oz.
Right.
You know, okay. So you take care of it.
Well, one of the things public art. Here's what I and I pass this along to Marie Jones. I like kinetic art. There are some fantastic artists right now that are making things that look like an optical illusion.
Oh, yeah. High tech.
Perfect spot out there on the mill site in our park and to draw people from town to go out there.
Okay.
This is some kinetic art.
Well,
so, and I'm behind promoting the arts 100%.
Well, that could be an add-on to this as well, but it's not promoting the arts. We are now the art capital of America, or at least California. And that, you know, when artists would start hearing that, you know what they're doing in Fort Bragg?
Right.
No, actually, it used to be Fort Bragg. It's New York Harbor. You see, they're taking down all the statues in the South of Civil War Confederate soldiers.
You know, and I brought this up at the last council meeting. I got a brochure from a sculptor, and he was wondering if we wanted some sort of statue here in town of some sort. And his statue that he sent a picture of is a guy with a lunch pail. I forget.
even a lager.
Who were here first? Well, a lager too. Well,
the statue of the Native American Indian to be laying down on the ground.
Well, I mean, it's to get rid of that, you know, Fort Bragg. It would be an answer to critics if they were here first.
Well,
you know, we came here to ostensibly protect the Indian, but in fact,
of course,
what we did was round them up, send them to Kovlo, decimate them.
Well, I tell you, I do own NoyoHarbor.org, and I'd be happy to donate to the city should they choose that. But people would prefer to go to a resort or a destination that had water and boating, and fishing, and beaches, etc., which Fort Bragg doesn't sound like it offers in any way, shape, or form. And then you have people who would go to a city that did take that effort to get rid of a Civil War person's name to try and right the wrong.
Well,
they attract the right kind of visitor.
You and I disagree on that. I think there's a lot of people who, like I said, many generations have lived here, and they're buried here, and this is Fort Bragg. We were Fort Bragg before North Carolina, Fort Bragg.
Well, but in that attitude, anything that's existed for a long time should not be changed.
Not necessarily, but I don't think we're not in the South. We did not send Confederate soldiers to General Lee.
A lot of them came here, though.
So you know what I'm saying? We're not really part of that whole Civil War argument. Whereas in the South they are, and so we didn't California. We weren't a Southern state.
Right, but suppose the town didn't have a name, and we had to vote on naming the town.
Right.
And Fort Bragg was on the list. How many votes would you get?
Well, if people knew that was the original name of this place, they'd get their B-votes.
They would be
because
surprised.
It wouldn't
win any top 10 prizes.
This was Fort Bragg, We weren't a nameless community. We didn't just come up out of
course.
And, we've kept our history. That's what's so great. Do you know who McPherson is? That's just not some name out of the blue.
No, I don't know. I wasn't named it.
Well, all these streets that have names are named after. Well, those are named after trees.
Oh,
we have oak, redwood. Those are the ones going east and west. And the ones that are going north and south are McPherson, or Whipple, or Harold. These are all names
love
of
Whipple,
our past.
Love Whipple, my favorite name in town.
All right. Harrison,
Well, the other point.
So
we've
kept our history. We didn't knock down the guest house. We kept the architecture here. We have a lot of history
beautiful town. You would
and
get
our name is part of that.
You would have to agree millions and millions of dollars worth of good publicity that you couldn't buy. Listen, I respect that.
You'd get bad publicity too. There'd be people, they just wanted to be politically correct. They kowtowed to those people that are all into political correctness.
I don't take it as an offense to be charged with being.
Well, like the feature, but there are people that do.
So the other thing is festivals. If we're going to do a festival, I thought we should do a festival of festivals.
Okay.
So
a community festival, by the way, in the long run, is more beneficial to your economy than coming up with like a concert every so often or whatever. Somebody sent me an article or gave me an article. I think it was a response.
You mean an annual?
Of
course.
Yeah.
It's like planting it grows.
Right.
So it would be a festival of festivals. It would be combining a half dozen festivals in one. So it would maximize the number of people that would want to come to it. So a festival that's not filling the town, this way you could, it would be a festival of festivals.
Well, that's a good example. So it'd be, you'd have wine, music, art, wine.
Here's poems and phones. You go from bar to bar, you drink and read poems. I mean, there's a lot of things you could do.
Right.
Singles, mingles, comedy, sports fishing. We could be the festival capital of California. But just having more than one would maximize the... and the other thing was we could have a giant auction. Or once a month in the summer, and everybody brings their stuff. I had an auction in Mendocino for 2 years. It was a huge success.
Mm-hmm.
We ran out of things to sell, but instead of having a yard sale, everybody on that date brings it and it's auctioned off. They get their money. The town gets 20% or whatever else. But people love auctions and they don't know what happens. Instead of all these garage sales and bring it to the auction house. We get a professional auctioneer here, and within a year or two, it would be, people would come here, dealers, antique collectors, everything. There's nobody doing an annual auction. I take care of that.
What's what you charge? We're there. It's all new.
Well, Don was going to come, but he decided to take his Mercedes Benz.
I like your festival idea.
All right. I think the auction
that's a good one, too.
Because you get 25%. The town actually collects money on it, and everybody gets rid of all the gets their stuff out of town.
Right.
And people like auctions. They're very popular. Very popular.
Yeah.
And you don't need a big description. It's an auction.
What about a fishing derby?
Well, that's fun. A lot of people do that, but that's going to bring you 100 people. A successful auction will bring in thousands. There's so many people who have little shops around or antique stores or whatever else.
Right. And well, I think events are really like the car show.
Oh, that's nice.
It was fun. It was great. The Rodders did a good job.
Yep.
We had a lot of people in town.
Absolutely.
And it was fun. It was good, clean. The weather was good.
And have it or eat.
No, to my knowledge, nothing in the police blotter, no trouble.
No.
Just brought the right kind of people, and everybody enjoyed it.
Yep.
And the locals enjoyed it. You know, the more things we can think of like that,
the Gangbangers Festival.
Yeah, well,
she has such a tough job. There's no cure for that.
Yeah.
You're a gentleman as always.
All right, thank you, Douglas.
And your company as well.
Coming in next week.
Tell your son, Douglas, says hello.
I will.
Okay.
And that's all, folks.
See you at the Wednesday meeting on the homeless.
What's that?
The Wednesday meeting.
Oh, yeah, Public Safety Committee.
Yeah, good.
Yeah, that's at 10 a.m. at Town Hall.
Yeah.